students. So in the previous classes, we were talking about that of the momentum and Newton's laws of motion. So momentum is what? Momentum is equal to the product of the mass and that of the velocity. It means momentum is directly proportional to the mass of the body as well as the velocity of the body. So if the mass of the body increases, the momentum also increases, or we can say the velocity of the body increases, then also the momentum increases. If we talk about the SI unit of the momentum, then the SI unit of momentum is equal to kg meter per second. Kg is the SI unit of the mass and velocity's SI unit is meter per second. Later on, we also studied that how can we apply the momentum in a different situations, or how can we see that momentum plays an important role in that of different conditions, okay, like that of a karate player. We also study the Newton's second law of motion. Newton's second law of motion states that the rate of change of momentum. So the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to that of the force, and it also depends upon the direction in which the force is applied. Okay? We derived that of the Newton's second law of motion, and we come to a conclusion that the force, Newton's second law of motion, it determines the relationship between the force and that of the acceleration. So acceleration of the body is directly proportional to the applied force and inversely proportional to the mass of the body. So F, it is equals to M into A, mass into acceleration. The SI unit of the force here is equals to kg meter per second square. Now today we will talk about the applications of the Newton's second law of motion. So student, when we talk about the application of the Newton's second law of motion, here we are simply talking about the observations that occur in our daily life, and on that basis, how can we explain the Newton's second law of motion? So basically, if you see the Newton's second law of motion totally depend upon the momentum. So here we have to reduce the momentum, and while reducing the momentum to zero, what will happen? It will prevent the injury because the force get reduced. The first application or the first example is the catching of a cricket ball. So what happened when you throw a cricket ball to a cricket player or to the fielder? So the fielder, he used to pull his hand gradually with the moving ball while holding a catch. What does this mean? It means if a fast moving ball is coming to a cricket player, he used to pull his hand backward or move his hand backward to catch the ball. This is to be done to reduce or to prevent the injury to the player's hand. So basically what happened here, student? Here, the fast moving ball is having the large momentum, okay? And we have to reduce the momentum of that fast moving ball to zero. Till that only we are able to catch or we are able to stop the ball when the momentum will get or momentum will reduce to zero. So what happened when the fielder, he catches the ball, he used to move his hand backward, and due to which the time taken to reduce the momentum, it get increased. So as the time will get increased, the rate of change of momentum, it will get decreased. And since the rate of change of momentum get decreased, the force which exert by the ball on his hand will also get reduced. Okay, so the opposing force will get reduced, or the force exerted by the ball on the hand get reduced. It will help in preventing any kind of injury to his hand. And that's why when the cricket player, he used to catch the ball, he used to take time or he used to move his hand backward, which increases the time and decreases the rate of change of momentum. What happens if suppose that cricket ball will, the cricketer will going to catch the ball instantly without moving his hand backward, then what happened? At that time, the change in the momentum or the momentum reduces to zero in a very short interval of a time. So here the time interval is less, so the rate of change of momentum will get increased. And when the rate of change of momentum will get increased, then the force exerted by the ball on his hand will also get increased, because that is directly proportional to the force. Okay, and due to which it will injure the hand of the player. And that's why he used to move his hand backward. So to prevent injury to his hand, always a cricket player move his hand backward on catching a fast cricket ball. So this is the first example. If you see the second example, student, you can see here, athletics meet. So during an athletic meet, what happened? A high jumping athlete, he is provided with a cushion or a heap of sand on the ground to fall upon. So here what happened, during this high jump, a high jumping athlete, he is provided with a cushion or a heap of sand. So as he or she jumps on the sand or on that of the cushion or the sand being soft, what will happen? It will help in reducing the momentum gently. It means this being soft, when the athlete he jump it, then you will see the heap of the sand being soft, it will get inside, so it will increases the time interval so that the momentum get to zero. And as the time interval increases, the rate of the change of momentum will decreases, and thus the force which is exerted by the opposing force exerted by the sand on the player will also get reduced, and thus it will reduces the, or it will prevents the injury to that of the player. Okay, so that's why the heap of a sand or the cushion is there for the high jumping athlete. There are other examples also, like that of a car seat belt is there. So you can see here, student. So these days, if you see that all the cars, they provided a seat belt, a stretchable seat belt is there, and it is mandatory to wear that. Why is this so, students? It is because this seat belt, it help in preventing the injury or any kind of accident that can occur. Basically, what happened, a fast moving car, if it stops suddenly due to accident and all, then the fast moving car is having the larger momentum, and that larger momentum it reduces to zero as it gets stopped. And the reducing of the momentum to zero, it takes place in a very less interval of a time. And due to which what happened, the passenger who is sitting or the driver who is sitting in the car, he will feel a jerk and he will fall in the forward direction or feel fall forward. Okay, so due to the presence or due to the seat belt which he has wore, then what happened, this seat belt, it increases the time of a sudden stop of the car. Okay, so due to the stretchable seat belt, it increases the time of the sudden stop, and due to which the passenger takes time to fall forward. Okay, so as the time increases, then the rate of change of momentum of the passenger, it get reduced. Okay, so basically what happened, when the car stops suddenly, the large momentum of the car get reduced to zero in a very short interval of a time. So the passenger, they fall forward. Okay, and due to the presence of the stretchable seat belt, that seat belt, it increases the time of the passenger to fall forward. Okay, as the time increases, then what happened? The rate of change of momentum of the passenger will also get in also it get reduced. Okay, so time increases, so the rate of change of momentum get reduced. And as the rate of change of momentum get reduced, the force which is acting on it, it will also get reduced, and thus it prevent injury or it prevent any kind of a disturbance to that of the passenger sitting in the car. Okay, so these are the different applications related to the Newton's second law of motion. Here you have seen that we are totally dependent upon the rate of change of momentum. So as the time increases, the rate of change of momentum get decreased. Okay, and it get decreased, due to which the opposing force or the force acting on it will also get decreased, and as the force get decreased, the chances of the injury will also get decreased. So it help in preventing or in reducing the injury by decreasing the rate of change of moment. Okay. Now we will talk about the another law of motion, and that is Newton's third law of motion. So to understand the Newton's third law of motion, if you see here, what you will see, a boy is there who is wearing a roller skate, and he is standing face towards that of the wall. Then he tried to put a force on the wall. You can see here, force on the wall. Okay, so he tried to push the wall with his hand, and what you will see, you will see that he himself moved backward. Okay, so as he tried to apply a force or as he tried to push the wall, the boy, he himself moves backward away from the wall. So it appears that if the wall also pushes the boy away from it, because you can see here that the boy, he was pushing or he was applying a force on the ball, and as he move backward, it seems that the wall also applies a force or it tries to push the boy away. So basically what happened here, students, when the boy, he exert a force on the wall by pushing it with his hand, then he exert a force on it, and as he exert a force, and the wall also exert an equal amount of a force in a opposite direction on the boy. And since the boy is wearing the roller skate, so the force which is applied on him makes him to move in a backward direction. Okay, so he applies a force on the wall, and the wall also apply an equal force on the boy in the opposite direction and makes him to move away. So by this we come to a conclusion of the Newton's third law of motion, that is, whenever one object exert a force on a second object, the second object will also exert an equal and opposite force on the first object. Okay, so there, if an object is there, you can see here, a force is what? It is the interaction between one object and the other. So if suppose that the boy, when he was pushing the wall, then he was applying a force on the object. The object is wall there, and the wall will also exert an equal and opposite force to the boy itself, and due to which he moves backward. So Newton's third law of motion, it explained that object whenever we apply a force on an object, then that object will also exert an equal and opposite force on the first object. So here, when we talk about the exert a force on a second object, and the second object will also exert an equal and opposite force. So you can see here are two type of a force working. One force which is applied by the first object, and the another force which is applied by that of the second force. Okay, so the force which is exerted by the first body on the second one, on the second body, that we call as a action force. Okay, that is a action force. Now the force which is exerted by the second object to that of the first object, what kind of a force is that? We use the term for it, that is reaction. So first is what? That is action, and the another one is a reaction. We can understand it when the boy, he was pushing the wall, then he was applying a force on the second object. The boy was the first object, so that was his action. But as the wall also apply an equal and opposite force makes him to move backward, that kind of a force is the reaction of the wall. So we will say that it is a reaction force. So one is action force, which is applied by the first person to the another, an object, or to that of the other person, and the same an opposite force applied by the second object or person to the first one, that is a reaction force. So here two forces are acting, and the both of the forces are equal and opposite in direction. So we can define the Newton's third law of a motion in a very simple way, that is, to every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. Because here we were saying that one object exert a force on the second object, that is action, and the second object exert an equal and opposite force on the first object, that is reaction. So the first is, so the if an action is there, a reaction is also there. So we will define it, to every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. So this is the Newton's third law of motion. Now we can understand the Newton's third law of motion by this. So if suppose we take a two spring balance is there. So two similar spring balances there, and which are connected together. You can see here A is there and B is there. A and B, they are connected together. And we fix the one of the spring balance to a rigid support. Okay. So what we will do here, when we apply a force on one of the spring balance by pulling the that free end of this spring balance, you can see here both of them are connected together here, and one is attached, one is fixed here with the help of a support. So when you pull the free end of one of the spring balance, and that is A, then what you will see that when you pull it, pull the free end of the spring balance A, then you will find that the spring balance, it shows the same reading in the A also, in the B also, both of them they show the same reading. So what is this shows? This shows that the force which is exerted by the spring balance A on A on B is equal, but in the opposite direction to the force exerted by spring balance B on A. Why is this so, student? You can see here why the reading is same in both of the spring balance, although we are pulling only one spring balance. So basically what happened here, when we pull the A spring balance, it exert a force of 100 Newton. You can see here it is written 100 newton. So it will exert a force of 100 newton on the B. Okay, so this A will exert a force of 100 newton on B, and the B also, B will pull the balance A with an equal force, that is of 100 newton, but this will be in the opposite direction. Okay, and that's why both of them shows the same reading. So here you can see that the A, spring balance A, when we pull this one, it will exert a force on B, and that force is equals to the 100 newton. And the B will also do the same thing. Now B will also pull the A in it towards its own direction. So it will exert a force which is equal to the 100 newton, or we can say it will exert the same amount of a force to the spring balance A, but this force exerted by the B on A will be in opposite direction. So A is trying to pull the B towards its own direction, and B try to pull it towards its own direction. So both of the direction are equal to, is opposite to each other, is in the opposite in direction to the force exerted, as well as if you see, but here the force, the amount of force is same. Here 100 newton is applied by the A on B, and here also 100 newton of force is applied by B on A. So in both the cases, the force applied by each by the spring balance on each other is same, but the direction is opposite to each other. Okay, so by this we comes to understand that the force exerted by the spring balance A on B is action, and the force exerted by spring balance B on reaction. So here the action and that of the reaction, they are opposite to each other, but the force is equal. So both of them, the action is having a equal and opposite reaction. Okay, so this is what, this is the, by this we can prove that the action and reaction are equal and opposite to each other. There is one more thing. Now you can see here, student, the action and reaction which act on a different bodies. So you see here, if suppose we kept a book on the table. Now, this book, there is an action forces acting on it as well as a reaction forces acting on it. The action force which is acting on the book, it pushes the book down to the table. Okay, so a force is which is a, we can say a weight is there, and that is an action which goes down, and again an equal amount of force will also act on the book, which we call as a reaction force, and this force is pushes the table up on the book. So one force is there which pushes the book down on the table, and one force is there, one an equal and opposite force is there, which makes the push book pushes upward. Okay, so one is pushing is downward and another is pushing it upward. So this is what, this is a Newton's third law of motion, in which every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Most of the time the questions which is asked in that of the Newton's third law of motion, basically it is a reasoning one, and it totally depends upon the examples. Okay, so we will see the examples of the Newton's third law of motion. So the first and the foremost thing that we see, that how do we walk? How do we walk, students? So we walk on the ground, and while walking, what we do, we used to push our foot to the ground, and when we push the ground with the help of our foot in the backward direction, in return the ground will also do the same thing and makes us to move forward. So here we are pushing our foot in the backward direction, and the road, it pushes ourselves in the forward direction. So here we are applying a force in the backward direction. So this is what it is, an action which we are applying on the earth or on the ground. And the ground or the road will also exert a force, that is a reaction, by which is an equal and opposite reaction. So it will also exert the same amount of a force, but in the forward direction, which is the opposite to the previous one. Okay, so the forward reaction exerted by the ground on our foot makes us to walk forward. There is one more thing which also work here, and that is the force of friction, student. The force of friction also plays a very important role while walking. So if the ground is slippery, or if we are standing on all ice, so it will be very difficult for us to move, because at that time the force of friction will be less. So the force of friction, if it is less, then it will be not easy for us to move forward. A very good example of that, one more thing is there. Like if suppose a person is swimming. So it is very similar to that of the of a walking, like we walk, we used to push the ground by our feet, by our foot to the backward direction. And in return, the ground, it pushes us to move in the forward direction. Same thing happen when a swimmer swims in the water. So what happened? The swimmer pushes the water in the backward by applies the force on the water to move backward with the help of his hand, as well as with the help of his feet. Okay, so as he try, or as with he applies the force with the help of his hand and feet, so that the water moves backward, the water in return also applies a force on the swimmer, and due to which he moves the forward direction. Okay, so he applies a force on the water, that is the action, and the reaction, which is an equal and opposite force, is applied by the water on him, and due to which he is able to swim easily in the water. Now one more thing is there, which is very important, that though the reaction and the action, these forces are equal in magnitude, but they do not produce this an equal acceleration. So force remains the same, but the acceleration acting on the both of the bodies, they might be different. Okay, and basically it is due to the different masses. Okay, so one is having high mass, one is having the small mass, and due to which the acceleration produced will be more in the body which is having the less mass, and the acceleration produced will be less in the body which is having the more mass. Okay, so we can say that maybe the force is the magnitude of the force is equal in both the cases, in both the object, but the acceleration varies here because the masses, they vary. So acceleration varies, but the force magnitude remains the same. There are a lot more examples of the Newton's third law of motion, like that of the recoiling of the gun. So when a bullet is fired from that of the gun, a force is applied by that of the gun, so that a bullet will move forward. And the equal amount of force is applied by the bullet to that of the gun, so that it will move backward. But since the mass of the gun is higher than that of the bullet, student, so it will go little bit backward. Okay, and due to which you feel a jerk on your shoulder. So what is this? This is the recoiling of the gun, and here also action is there by which we applied a force with the help of a gun. We applied a force on the bullet and it moves forward, and it will also applies a equal amount of a force to the gun so that it will move backward. Although due to the variation in the mass, one will move forward very easily, but the other will move backward for a short distance. Okay, although we can feel the jerk of movement of the gun in the backward. Other examples, you can see here a sailor, when he jumps out of the boat, he exerts a backward force on the boat. And so what happened, you can see here, when he moves forward, he applies a force on that of the boat. So as he exert a backward force on the boat, which we call as an action, the boat will also exert an equal and opposite amount of a force on the sailor, and that is a reaction, and due to which the sailor jumps forward. So this sailor, he exerts a force in the backward direction on the boat, and the boat will also applies an equal an opposite amount of a force on the sailor and makes him to move forward. Is there, that is the action which is applied in the backward direction, and one is the reaction which is applied in the forward direction. Okay, so this is the example, third example of the Newton's third law of motion. We will discuss the other examples also, and I told you that all these type of questions, whenever asked according to the Newton's third law of motion, basically it is a reasoning type, and it totally dependent upon the type of the examples. Okay, so the questions which is framed, it is from the examples itself, so we have to see the examples very thoroughly. Okay, so the questions, most of the time it will be asked, if it is from the Newton's third law of motion, it will be asked from the example itself. Okay.